Good morning, all of you. Once again, a warm welcome to the second day of the session of the workshop on taming data science with real life use cases. Today we have we'll have the opening session with our faculty, Dr. Lakshmi, who is an academician and a research person with extensive research background. She has published multiple papers in machine learning and has few patents also in her name. Her interests are machine learning, data science, education tools, and AI. And she's a research officer at BVR at the Hyderabad. So welcome, Lakshmi ma'am, to the workshop. And now the floor is yours. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Good morning, all of you.
Yeah, good morning.
Yeah, good morning. Today we are going to start with data modeling stages and pre-processing. Yesterday, good that Mr. Krishnan mentioned 70% of the time everyone should spend on data pre-processing, 20% on modeling, 10% on interpretation or tuning the model. So this is how the data science works. There is a science and there is art also. The meaning of science, most of the data modeling activities, 80% of the data modeling activities, it will be fixed. There is a formula, there is a method across the globe, whomever thinks in that perspective, it should be common. There are certain area needs to be done artistically. So that is where the individuality plays a role, individual's talent plays a role. So for that, some kind of latent thinking is required, some kind of the experiential, the exposure is required. These are all the three key combination I can recommend for artistic nature. Where the artistic nature comes into the picture? In the pre-processing, only artistic nature. When it comes modeling, when it comes interpretation or tuning, there may be mostly science. If the value says, Curtis's value says more than four, if we interpret in different way, then we will end up with a lot of loss with business profitable action. So whenever, after that pre-processing section, whenever we approach the rest of the stages of the data modeling, it's all full of science. Where the artistic nature lies only with the pre-processing. So it is a time we may able to teach, a time we may not able to teach. That's why data pre-processing, most of the online courses, they may not touch upon to the fullest. But here we are trying to attempt in this today's session, how we can give this part also. That is a unique highlight of this workshop, what you are all registered for. So with that note, let me start with number one, data is ready to speak with us or speak with you. That is a appropriate word I can write because everyone is thinking in different perspective. Data is ready to speak with you. Are you ready to listen? It's a kind of data science proverb. Lot of cartoons, memes, proverbs, people are creating. I'm fond of that. Although I am working on models, I like than models. These are all the stuff like modern proverbs on data science and machine learning, modern memes and the cartoons on data science and machine learning. This is how I like. So this says data is ready to speak with you. Are you ready to listen? So this is what pre-processing or exploratory data analysis. We can name it as pre-processing, also we can name it as exploratory data analysis. How we can understand what data is speaking? Only through pre-processing and exploratory data analysis we can understand. So this is what we are going to try for another 1 hour. So what data is ready to speak with us, how we are understanding about data. Then after understanding the data, only we can think of model, picking the model. Unless otherwise data is not understood thoroughly, picking the model may end up with a wrong prediction. So that pre-processing and exploratory data analysis is mandatory. Now let us move with the stages of data modeling. Reading data formats, structured data. When it comes to machine learning, most of the time we will be working with structured data. Name it time series data or formatted data, all are structured data. When it goes to deep learning, we will be working with unstructured data. So most of the time, deep learning deals with unstructured data. It doesn't mean that it cannot deal with the structure. It will deal with the structure as well. The moment we look at unstructured data, deep learning is the only solution, not the machine learning. So what are all the formatted data we will be getting? Excel is one of the formatted data. The moment we see rows and the columns pattern, table pattern, are a systematic way of articulating the description of the data, then it becomes structured data. Excel is one of the best example for structured data. We will be finding in the form of Excel most of the time. If we come across the data coding platforms like Kaggle, GitHub, we will be getting UCA machine learning repository. There are more than 20-30 data platforms are available. They are donating the data ready-made available, but other way we can do web scraping and we can collect the data. It is also possible. CSV is another variant of Excel. So it's a comma separated view. If we look at Excel, it provides this format also. So interchangeably, I can say both are same, Excel and CSV. However, when picking the function or coding time with the Python, we need to be careful. If you are reading Excel, appropriate command suitable for the Excel file reading we need to use. If we pick a CSV, appropriate function suitable for reading CSV, we need to use SQL. We can handle SQL data as well using Python. So SQL is highly structured. That name itself, structured query language. Then JSON and BSON, Java Object Notation, Key Value Pair Notation. BSON is the binary object notation. That is the difference between JSON and BSON. This is also a structured data type. It's a key value pair. When if you look at most of the web data will be available in the form of key value pair. JSON is useful for web analytics, any form, social media analytics, if you do sentiment analysis, whatever the form you are trying to do, web analytics in the umbrella system, I'm talking web analytics, mostly we need to refer this JSON and BSON representation. Then XML is another, this is also structured markup language, extended markup language. It is also available in the form of structured data. Certain information we may not be able to represent with a columnar manner or row and column manner. By that time, XML is the only format available with us. The same data, probably Mr. Kannan may be walking through or walk through the COVID data. COVID data, what is available is in the form of text file. So text file also possible for looking at the data or useful for analyzing the data. So these are all the data sources. We can think of, we cannot expect all the time Excel. Depending upon the business problem statement, the format would be changing. Then we must be in the position to read that format. We must be in the position to understand the format and to process the format and interpret what that particular representation says. This is the first expected, the talent we must possess. Most of the time we will be looking at the Excel data, but when it comes real-time problem situation, we cannot expect Excel alone. It would be in any form of data or combinations of data. Whenever you go to banking data analysis, they would be interacting with several servers, several kind of activities they will be taking care. Then the source of data comes from each and every server, each and every representation, or DB would become different. At times they may say combining multiple data set in order to explore or fix the problem or a profitable solution they may be expecting to provide by the data scientist. So by that time also we need to work with the multiple format combinations. So that is an awareness I wanted to bring now. Let us move to the next. Once the data reading is ready, data is ready to read, or it is in the form of readable mode. We successfully read and we have seen the data is available in the RAM memory or in the data frame. The moment we come to Python code, it is termed as data frame. So if it is available, then what next we supposed to do? We need to do first handling with the missing value. There are plenty of situation that would lead to missing value. Whenever we look at the websites, e-commerce websites like second hand sales car or any kind of e-commerce websites, that the website would be different for the customer, it would be different for the administrator or who are all working behind that data backup and the data streaming mechanisms. So it would be different. Customer should become customer friendly. They should be able to understand. We may not put more technical terminology, rather than it should go with the business terminology. I give one scenario for when the missing value will come. If the data is related to human entry, manual entry, lot of chances for missing value. They may tend to miss unconsciously or typographically, or if they are not able to interpret that particular situation, they may miss it. So that is the way missing value will come. When it is automated, if you look at second hand calls, car sale, they will be putting different way. Do you met accident? In that case, what need to be put if the person doesn't know? Nil, zero. Sometimes they may feel irritated to look at that column. So they may not fill that also. They may hide also. Anything may happen. So in that situation, that customer will not be entering that particular column value to the fullest. Then it would lead to missing value. Then what are all the way missing value is represented? Empty cell is one of the understanding of missing value. If that particular cell in the Excel sheet is empty, then it is missing value. Then double question mark is also possible. NA, not applicable. NAN, not a numerical. So possibly, and single question mark. For most of the time, these are all the combinations. They are treating it as missing value widely across the globe. There may be some other representation also, I'm not sure. So possible representation of missing values. Then if the data has missing value, model cannot be built. Mathematical cannot work on empty. Computer cannot recognize emptiness. That is non-trivial solution. That is different topic. So question mark, how we can interpret whether that question mark is what kind of representation, how we need to treat, that is another question mark. So NAN, single question mark, empty cell. So these are all those things need to be cleaned first. We need to, the moment we read the data, we need to close our eyes. We need to look at, is there any missing value in terms of column or in terms of row or in the entirety of the data sheet which we are using. We need to first blindly, we need to verify emptiness. If the data says no null value, no empty, then we can proceed boldly. So that is then how to treat missing value. I am discussing exclusively. So what are all the way we can treat? The proportion of missing value goes in different approaches than how to treat. The proportion is also a matter. The quantity is also a matter. The quality of the missing value is also a matter. That all we look at subsequently. Then data consistency check. What is a data consistency check is? For example, I am running e-commerce business. I am running fashion cloth showroom. If every day my business goes only 1,000 rupees of purchase order or 2,000 or at the max 10,000, all of a sudden 2-3 instances comes with a cross, then I need to be careful. Something, the data arrival, rate of arrival, somewhere data is manipulated. Never I was running the business with the fashion commerce with 1 crore. Never I did it. All of a sudden it comes 1 crore or some cross. Then that is a position we need to pay attention, where the wrong is going on. Is the data representation is going wrong, or the data streaming is going wrong, or any hacking or whatever may happen. Consistency need to be verified. At the max, my e-commerce business may go up to 25 lakhs, let me consider. But beyond that, never I did a business transaction. So we need to find out that the consistency in the row level and in the column level. Then while considering the data, none of the two rows should become similar data column. Uniqueness need to be verified. Uniqueness means entire row, there is a chance for repeating while storing, a technical flaw or a manual problem, whatever may be the reason. So it will start repeating, the redundancy. Redundancy should not be available. These are all the combination I am trying to tell, consistency check. If the same row repeats again and again multiple time, or at least one more time, similarly several rows repeats multiple time, that all would lead to wrong answers or wrong model building. So that we need to treat it or clean it. Whenever we consider training data, testing data, there is no botheration. You can have in any order. Training data should become unique. Every row, it should become unique. That is a primary consideration. This is second, data consistency check. It should become consistent. We used to say, no, consistent behavior. All of a sudden, you are talking nicely. Then one day, you are showing angry to me. You are misbehaving with me. That is inconsistency. So it should become same rhythm, same way of representation. All of a sudden, it deviates to the upper extremity or to the lower extremity. That is termed as inconsistency. It should not be available. So we need to check out, really, is that a business transaction happened in that? We need to look at the data range. There are several ways to look at the consistency. We can consider that. Then there are very few peculiar cases are there. What to do? Plenty are there. What to do? Inconsistency, if the data is arrived to our desk, we may not be able to go back and correct the business. If it is a healthcare analytics, highest deviation comes in the EEG signal, ECG signal, or any kind of MRI scan, whatever. We cannot go and correct the patient. That instead of correcting the patient, we need to treat the data. So by the time, how to treat the treating mechanisms subsequently. Then dummy variable encoding. What is the dummy variable encoding? Let us move it. If we look at the data, any of the particular column is categorical data type. First, we need to understand what are all the data types involved in our data set. In terms of column otherwise termed as attribute, feature, parameter, variable, X and Y representation. These are all the interchangeable words they used to use. So we need to look at data type of each and every column. That is primary concern. Why we need to look at for this dummy variable encoding? If we look at model building, the model building is entirely working on principle of statistics, principle of probability and calculus. This is the calculus and linear algebra. These are all the four primary mathematical models supports are helpful for model building. Then if we look at mathematics, none of the mathematical formula accepts the string. And for example, data science, if you pass, you can't pass data science as an input parameter to the statistical model. It should become numerical. Either it can be integer or it can be float. That doesn't matter. But string data type or character data type, we cannot pass it as input to the formulae. Never we would have come across. That we can agree. From the childhood, we are all taught every formulae will take only the numerical value. That is what we are all taught. So that any information available in the form of categorical or it is available in the form of string data type, that need to be translated into numerical. Only then model could be built. So what is categorical? For example, I am running a fashion showroom. Male wear, female wear, male traditional wear, male fashion wear. Like that, I need to give you whenever a single transaction moves out, what kind of product is moving out from my shop? That I need to keep on eye. Why I am keeping on eye? So that I can think of increasing the price of the product. I can make more profit. I need to place order, inventory management. I should know which product is moving fast. I need to fill the stock. So in that situation, these are all the keywords highly useful. Directly human can interpret. Okay, in my shop, male fashion wear is moving fast. So then I need to focus on how I can make more profit on that product because it's fast moving. Or how I can attract customers further by giving discounts. What is the proportion of discount I can give? Anything you can look at on that data. It is mandatory. Always this categorical is mandatory. It is inevitable. Gender. Then looking at gender only, I can understand who is purchasing more in my shop. So that gender is also categorical, inevitable. So then size of the product, whether XL, double XL, which is moving fast. So that is also another criterion. Although the malware is moving fast, whether medium, large or small size, double XL is moving fast, that also you should consider. I cannot place order when triple X is moving fast, I cannot place order for double XL. So I need to think of which size is moving fast also. So these are all the consideration. It is mandatory, always it is inevitable. We can see the categorical data. Very rarely we will be getting the data full of numerical. Every column is of the form numerical. Very rarely we used to get. Otherwise categorical data would be available. So we need to transform this categorical data to numerical representation. For that, there are few techniques. That also I will be discussing shortly. Right now, it has been introduced. So what are the way we can pre-process or clean the data? These three can be said as cleaning the data. Next, we move on to exploratory data analysis. It comes a little bit more scientific. Only one property or aspect would become artistic. Feature engineering is the only property artistic. Rest all the property going to become scientific. The moment I say scientific, if I do also, I'll be doing in that understanding perspective only. If anyone else does also, the same perspective only, he or she will be carrying out. So feature engineering is artistic, rest of all scientific. So scientific means fixed. Throughout the globe, whomever does, everybody will try to do the same. Now, first attempt is descriptive analysis. This descriptive analysis always helps for understanding the data. Mean, mode, median, standard deviation, variance, there are several. Interquartile analysis, these are all the, there are plenty. Depending upon the context, what is a problem statement, we need to understand the data as well. So when before building the model, understanding of the business domain is important. Understanding of the data is important. Understanding of the particular problem statement is also important. So when we come to data science, there are a few steps. Let me complete that first. Domain understanding is mandatory. If the data comes from agricultural data, then I must be knowing the background, the source of agriculture with automation. What are the type of sensor is accustomed in that automation? Something, some background I should know. Why they are reading that parameter? What is the purpose of moisture, reading the moisture? Then what would be the range in India or that particular zone, that particular state? What would be the range? Normally it would go, the moisture level would go in that kind of little bit idea we should have. Then temperature, then what would be the lowest temperature on that day and the highest temperature, that range, some working idea we should have about that domain understanding. Then data exploratory, this is the second concern. Next, model building. Next, tuning, or whatever we want we can do tuning. Then subsequently, interpretation. These are all the stages, major stages. So the domain understanding, in order to understand the domain, descriptive analytics will be useful. So I will be demonstrating how each and every thing can be done subsequently. So descriptive analysis is one of the key concerns to understand the data or distribution of the data, or the nature of availability of the data. All those things will speak some extent. Then normality check is primary concern. 80% of the statistical tool, especially when it comes to machine learning, I can say, I'm not sure about other statistical tool, machine learning, 80% of the machine learning model will work on the principle called normal distribution. The data must be normally distributed. This is colloquially can be said as bell curve. Technically, it is called normal distribution curve, Gaussian distribution curve. These are all the technical terminology. So it looks like a bell. The deep bell shape should take. I may be not good in drawing with mouse. So this is the bell curve. So this bell curve, the column, the numerically distributed, the numerical data. The moment we understand the column is numerical data type, It could be floating data or it could be integer data. That data we need to check for the normality. It should be normally distributed, not exactly, at least more or less normally distributed. So for that, there are two methods. We can do the normality check with the statistical packages, or we can check the normality with a plot. It's a simple, if you are confused with a lot of formula and scientific terminology and statistical packages, simple, we need to be thorough with visual plot. We need to plot that column. Then if it resembles this kind of texture, this kind of appearance, then we feel that convinced, we can proceed with. Then if not, statistically, we can go for skewed check. We can go for Python provides normality check itself. Python provides a function. Then curtosis, there is another statistical component that shows distribution, that 68% of the data should be distributed within this density. Then 95% of the data should be distributed within this density. Some checks are there. If I display the slide, it will be much more, but more or less this is what it's saying. That based on the distribution, compactness of the data, this is called a normal distribution. For example, in a class, if at all I'm an academician, so I need to take academic example. In my class, there are 66 students available. When my data will become normal, when my data will not become normal, I'll tell. There are two scenarios. One is, in my class, there are guys trying to score. Five students trying to score less than 10. Five students trying to score less than 20, means 10 to 20. Then five students that equally distributed. Five students are scoring 20 to 30. Yet another five, like, and so on. Imagine 90 to 100, five students. Then 80 to 90, five students. 70 to 80, five students. That is a exact proportion of marks scored by my students. 60 students or 100 students, whomever may be. Then if I distribute perfectly, it will take normal distribution. When the normal distribution form will not work out, I tell you, only five students got less than 10 in my class. All other 55 students have got above 90. Naturally, teacher like this kind of distribution only for the sole satisfaction. The first one we don't like, but for statistically, it is telling normally distributed. This is one example when normally distributed, when normally not distributed. I think, hope you can able to understand. Then this plot will become bulky on that highest side, the tail side, the long tail we will get. Only five students would be getting that lesson marker. So that shifting is called a skew. If it perfectly, this peak looks at the center, then it is normally distributed. That the peak is moved on to the right side or left side, then it is termed as right side. If it is moved based on the tail only, they will tell left skew, right skew. So that need to be treated. Why we need to treat would be the next question. For example, consider another scenario. In a class, I want to give some discount offer for my workshop. I want to look at the economical background of my students. Those who have lesser economical status, I'm going to put some ceiling. Let me consider annual income must be less than 5 lakhs. Annual income must be less than 3 lakhs. Let me consider. Those who are all having annual income less than 3 lakhs, I want to give a discount. In that scenario, I am going to calculate mean value. Mean is the only solution. Average is the only solution to find out less than 3 lakhs or whatever. If I want to understand the pattern of students, one is you can do if check. If the annual income is less than 3, less than 3, less than 3, like that you can do. But the mean value will give us more or less what is a way of distribution, or what is the background of my students' economical status. That mean value is sufficient. When I calculate mean value, all my students' profile are similar, more or less similar. All of a sudden, one multi-crore or crorepatis, some VIPs, VIP cadre, there are several cadre. One is based on the qualification, one is based on the economical status, one is based on the power of execution, like that. Economical status, imagine Ambani family background person is coming and studying in my college. Then their annual income would become highly different. Then just because of that one instance, it will mislead the average. The moment mean is misleaded, all other statistical package, standard deviation, square root, anything we do on it, then everywhere it will mislead. Mean is a core component for most of the statistical analysis. Mean is a core component for all the model building. Then that mean itself deviated just because of that one person. So even if you run a business, extremities would be there. Most of the customer will purchase on the daily basis 1,000 rupees only. Only 5% or 1% of the customer will purchase in terms of lakhs with Amazon. Even you look at that data set, minimum they will put some constraint. 500 if you purchase only, delivery is possible to your zone. Some condition they will put, or 300, whatever. Then that is going to become predominant, that minimum purchase. 300 to 500 zone, some range what they put, that is predominantly available. Then mostly people will purchase in terms of thousands. Very rarely lakhs together purchase order will go. Then if we mix this all data, model will get deteriorated. We need to normalize whether the person purchases for 1 crore also, person purchases 5 lakhs also, person purchases 300 rupees also, this data need to be understood or predicted or analyzed. So in order to fix the mean value deviation or reduce the standard deviation or reduce the variance, we need to bring down to the normality. That is the answer for why question. There are plenty of answer. What lens I am wearing and looking at, I am telling. So normality check. If it is not available, normality, I cannot go back to the customer, why you purchased 300 rupees? My data is not normally distributed. Purchase for 3 lakhs rupees, I cannot tell. So that is not in our control. We need to transform this not normally distributed to normally distributed. So for that, 600 plus normalization techniques available. Predominant, although 6,600 normalization technique available, there are few techniques are useful for the normalization process. One is Z-score, another one is log transmission, another one is min-max transmission. Min-max transformation works well for the analogy which I gave. Purchase order trend of each and every customer with Amazon, whatever. So min-max, we need to normalize who is the highest paid customer, who is the least paid customer. That will give us min value, max value. With that, we are normalizing every other customers. So then it will take to the transformation of more or less uniformity. Then you may ask question, you are misleading the solution. Not at all. Although we are transforming, that originality will be there. Who is having highest purchase value? Who is having very least purchase value? I would have purchased only 300 rupees. Somebody would have purchased the 3 crores. There are other people will purchase between these two. So it will retain that distribution. It will retain, but more or less it will bring the value to the normal scale. So this is the, then we need to look at the other transformation, what we need. Every transformation has got its own beauty. This 600 normalization technique alone, we can take up as a research thing that we can do. Academicians, we do research, and industrialists, they will apply every research and they will run the business. So when we look at other transformation, we need to look at the distribution of the data. If the distribution of the data is quadratic, then we need to apply different transformation for the normality. If the distribution of the data is cubic, if the distribution of the data is what shape it takes, the distribution, that original distribution we need to understand, then what would become combination to transform to bell curve or normality. That kind of formula we can apply. If really we don't know that background, then it would take one full day understanding the normalization technique itself. One day or 1 month also, I'm not sure. That much stuff is available. That is why people will do 5 to 6 normalization technique they will pick. They will do one after other. which because it's coding, no? If we know coding for Z-score normalization, log transformation, min-max transformation, or whatever we know for transformation, for that coding we should know. Then we can copy paste, we change the parameter, then we run the model. Maybe 5 minutes we will get the result, or 10 minutes of executing all other remaining portion of the coding. Then we see if it is improved, we will feel happy. If it is not improved, then worse than the previous technique, then we need to change the normalization rate. Trial and error basis. So you can understand scientifically, we can do. For that, we should understand the basically how it is distributed. Then we can do the appropriate normalization technique. If we don't understand, pick up 5 to 6 transformation technique. Let us know the coding. That is how I do. Copy paste, change the parameter and build the model. If it gives good result, be happy. If not, change the normalization technique. Okay. Next, correlation check. This is another big story. Every line has a vast kind of information. So let us go to correlation check. Why we need to do correlation check? This is the first question. What is correlation? Probably you all may be knowing. If I eat more food and more calorie food, I will put on weight. Correlation, direct correlation. If I keep on eating that also more calorie food, every day I will put on one weight also. There is no miracle in it. So that is direct correlation. If I walk every day 5 hours, 10 hours, 3 hours, my weight will be reducing. That is negative correlation. The first one is positive correlation. Second one is negative correlation. It's supposed to reduce my weight. More and more my exercise increases, lesser and lesser my weight would become. So that is negative relativity. But that is also correlated. My weight reduction is highly correlated with my exercise. And also food, I agree. But I'm trying to tell example. Correlation gives lot of benefit in most of the statistical analysis. This is the main consideration we should do. When it comes to variable, I'm not sure. Yesterday I was attending up to Christian sir's session. After that I didn't attend. So we must know these two variables. Independent variable, dependent variable. We need to fix these all first in our data modeling before going to the data modeling. Independent variable, otherwise termed as X variable. Dependent variable, otherwise termed as Y variable. Feature variable, something. Let it be. That is another kind of discussion. It's very rudimentary level, but. So independent variable, dependent variable is a prime concern for the correlation check. We need to find out correlation between, relation between X and Y. Or I mean to say relation, correlation. X and Y first. Then we need to find the relation between X and X. Both are required. But the purpose of identifying relation between X and Y is different. The purpose of identifying relationship between X and X is different. The purpose of identifying relationship X and X is, next line, look at multicollinearity check. I am telling here multicollinearity check. The first one, X and Y relationship is correlation check. So these are all the foundation. This is the essential foundation before even going to build the model. Now, X and Y check, why we need to do. Here, whenever we get more correlation, that variable, independent variable, X variable need to be retained. If it gives lesser correlation, 0.2, 0.5, 0.3, these are all useless features. We can throw it away. So it is not ready to explain something. For example, what is a correlation, or here I mean to say is, I'm asking one of you to talk about me for 1 hour. Is it possible? None of you know me earlier. You are seeing me exactly by 10:15. So you cannot speak about me anything. You may speak one line, the session is good or bad. That's all. 1% only you can start explaining. Rather, I'm going to invite my husband. I'm asking him to speak about 1 hour. It is possible. My plus, minus, everything he can speak for 1 hour. So who is better in order to one of you want to understand me? Which is better? Instead of talking to my husband, am I yourself, if you try to discuss, you cannot understand anything. that is waste of time. You are wasting. Who gives more explanation, more articulation? Through them only you can get more information. Better if you want to understand me, you need to speak with my husband, not anyone else. So that is the best solution. Similarly, here it is possible to bring that relationship. Whichever the correlation gives more and more, above 5, minimum it should become above 5, between X and Y. That X variable we need to retain. If it is giving very poor correlation, 0.3, 0.2, 0.1, that are all useless. Nothing can be spoken about, can be helping for model prediction. Those variables are junk variable, useless variable. That is the way we can do dimensionality reduction. Even yesterday, Mr. Christian was mentioning, if the columns are too huge, you may need to reduce it. So that this is one kind of dimensionality reduction. So looking at the correlation itself, if it is 0.3, 0.4, 0.4 is also okay, I think so. 0.2, 0.1 and all useless. It will strain your model. It will make a more strainful, that should not be treated, need to be thrown out. That is the primary concern. Then when you will get a perfect prediction, more accuracy, if your independent variable, at least one, if it has more than 9 correlation between X and Y. Y is fixed. X only plenty will be there. Y is predictive variable or dependent variable. For any model we build, one Y only we will retain. Remaining all X. So imagine 5X, one Y. Among 5, who is having more than 0.9 high correlation? Or ultimately 0.99, if it is much more better, almost this X fellow can talk about this Y fellow too much. So that this kind of variable, if it is available, you are lucky. If it is not available, we cannot do anything, but we can throw the least representative variable. Then rest all combination 0.6, 0.5, 0.7, like that, if you have every variable trying to explain something, then all together the prediction would become better. What is the meaning of prediction is, you are trying to understand me professionally, they are inquiring my students, inquiring my colleagues and officials, and you are trying to inquire my husband also. Every person is giving some 60%, 50% of information to you. Then all together you can predict about my behavior much better. So that is also well advisable if it is not there. If the high correlation 0.9 is not there, then this is the another way the prediction is going on. Next, X related to X. X related to X. What is the meaning? It is called multicollinearity. That, how I will tell you. Among X and X, one correlation exists. Both are trying to speak the same. If you ask my, one of my other family member, if I ask my husband, both would be telling the same. So not required. Two member, you no need to sit and inquire about me. Waste of time. Waste of effort. So you can throw one. Then another question, how to throw, whom to approach. One of my aunt is also ready to explain me a lot. My husband is also ready to explain me a lot. Whether you will approach my aunt or you will approach my husband is a question mark. You need to pick, choose. So that is another stage, that much we no need to worry. Or else another method I'll tell, trial and error. Do start retaining one of the variable, then build the model, see the accuracy, then remove that variable, substitute that other eliminated variable, build the model, see the accuracy, whichever gives better, we can do. If you are not ready to explore the science, then trial and error is the only solution. X or X, that should not be available. Here X versus X correlation versus this high correlation, near one should not be there. Between X and X, near one should not be there, correlation. Both you should not retain. Both if you are retaining, what is the meaning is, I'm going to my friend's house, they are offering tea, yalachi flavor. I'm going to my relative's house, they are offering tea, some other flavor, cinnamon flavor. I'm going to one more person's house, they are giving clove tea. So all are tasting good. Just because of that, if I mix all three, then masala tea will come. If I consume, I may vomit also. So that is the kind of thing. Every tea is very good. Trying to explain, every variable is trying to help for the prediction. But all if you retain, collapse will happen. So this fellow will dominate that fellow, that fellow will dominate that fellow, because of that confusion, model cannot predict better. So that whenever among X's, if you have high correlation near 1.99, 0.8, by the time we need to be careful. So that multicollinearity is not permitted. Multicollinearity can be done with the correlation, or it can be done with VAF. VAF is another method. So this is another method. Whichever you prefer, you can use, but you should know when you are going for industry, they may definitely touch upon what is multicollinearity, what is the use, why something like that during your interview. Then you should know what are all the way you can identify the multicollinearity. One is through correlation technique, another one is through this VAF technique. VAF has some expansion, I'm not sure right now. So variable inflation factor. Yeah, varying inflation factor, something like that. You search in the Google, that's a VAF acronym. So these are all the possible way of doing multicollinearity. Condenser, almost we reached 11. Will you permit at least to walk through this slider? It is a kind of ocean. That is why data science people used to run for short-term course, minimum 3 months, 5 months, 6 months.
Condenser, yeah, you can wrap it in 10 minutes.
Yeah, that is okay, a signal.
Thank you.
Multicollinearity check over, removal of unwanted column. By looking at the data itself, looking at the domain perspective itself, we can understand. These are all the column not required, useless. This won't be helpful for the problem statement for that particular context. With our gut feeling, intuitive sense, we can remove the column. That is also possible. Feature selection. There are scientific technique feature selection available. So with that, we can do feature selection. The feature engineering. Feature engineering is artistic nature, not the scientific. The meaning of artistic nature is looking at the data, transforming the data into the more explainable format. I'll tell what is a more explainable format. Whenever it comes to second-hand car sale, they will ask year of purchase. Then year of that or month of sale. These two they will type. These two will not help our machine to predict anything fruitfully. With the year, the moment the timestamp comes, we need to be very careful. Timestamp is most of the time we need to work on feature engineering. So this year alone, if you pass, nothing will be predicted by the machine. So that what we should do, we need to calculate age of the car. It may be funny, but we need to calculate age of the car in terms of months. This is one scenario I'm telling. So how we can calculate age of the car? It is easy, you know, now. Then scientifically you can go. First we should know how these two columns merged or transformed into much more explainable way. Then even we the human, if I give 500 car to your brain and ask you to sit and analyze, this is the year of purchase, this is the year of sale, how your brain will work? Imagine how much is strainful. Rather I'm converting into 43 months used, 100 months used, 150 months used, more and more the months, less and less, lesser and lesser the car price. You need to fix lesser value. So 5 months used, 3 months used. There are people purchases with sentiment or due to their plenty of surplus of money, they will immediately dispose. So anything may happen. So that the moment I convert it into months, how quick your brain is working on and fixing the price for the car. Rather, if I give year of purchase, month of sale to you, your brain will get confused. Totally, you will go mad, strainful. You will be stressful, you will feel angry also. So similarly, for the machine also will happen. Machine will not show angry, model performance will be reduced. So that I need to feed the data suitable for the prediction, is for understanding by the model. For that, this is what. Another analogy I'll give. Second-hand or first, a fresh house sale. You must ask your customer to enter, the person who is selling. Then buyer and seller both should talk in the same language. Suppose I'm having duplex house. Then if I'm trying to sell, I'm the construction or a builder. Then I may be a builder, I may be disposing my old house. then I need to give them the clear picture to the customer before purchasing. What is my total area? What is my built up area? What is my ground floor? What is my first floor? What is my second floor? Square feet. Every floor also I should give total area, free space, and I should give free space, I should give built up area also. If I feed like this to the machine, machine will get confused. But when the sell buyer is ready to purchase, he can look at in any angle, because he will pick one according to his budget. 10 or 15 house only he will identify, then he will sit and think and brainstorm with his family member, then he will purchase. That is easier, but a machine cannot do. How we need to transform is total area, total built up area, total free area. These kind of information we need to feed to the machine, or else better to give built up area. We need to sum up built up area of each and every floor. We need to sum up free area of each and every floor. These two only we should give instead of this 5 column. When we give more and more information related to one context alone, that will deteriorate the quality of the model. So that we need to do feature engineering here also. That is why domain understanding is important. Machine learning is also important. If you understand both, some optimized decision we can do. That optimized decision is called transformation. That is called feature engineering. Next, independent variable, dependent variable identification. This is the primary concern. I need to transform to the first level. Dimensionality reduction. There are scientifically available. Dimensionality is the curse. More columns if I give, machine will feel tired. You cannot give prediction. So it needs to be reduced into lower dimension. The moment this word need to be cautioned. Dimension is not the row. I can substitute 1 lakh rows also. That much not required. Probably 10,000 rows, 15,000 rows sufficient for prediction or model building. But row is not a concern, primary concern here. Dimensionality is column. How many appropriate column we need to pass? Already I said the removal of unwanted column. Depending upon the problem statement, we can remove. Then based on the multicollinearity, that correlation, we can remove. Based on multicollinearity also, we can remove. Beyond that also, imagine you have 70 columns. What you can do? Every column you feel so important for the prediction. Then you need to go for scientific technique, principal component analysis, linear discriminant analysis. These are all the two analysis techniques. They're plenty, widely popular. So these two you can use it. Then another one is outlier. This outlier is extremity. In my class, all are getting above 99, above 90. Only one guy is getting zero. He is the extremity. In my class, all are getting less than 50. Only one guy is getting 100 out of 100. He is extremity. So that outliers should not be there. What is the purpose of outlier is, it will drag the attention towards that. The entire model should pay the attention to that outlier. Then model building approach will be deteriorated again. So that outlier never ever we should keep. There is no more decision. Throw it out. That is the only solution. So that outlier transformation, or you can build with outlier, without outlier, then again there is a chance of probability if there is no science. Then data transformation, all these together, whatever we do, feature selection, all together it is termed as data transformation. Finally, the data which is obtained need to be transformed suitable to the model, machine learning model. Next, data split. The proportion of split is important. Train test split, that is called row wise split. If we have 10,000 record, how we need to split it for training and testing? Column split. Then that a column need to be combined into 4 component, X train, Y train, X test, Y test. We need to split. That Python code itself will help you. So here nothing more. This proportion only we need to do. Why this to be done? Again, some story. Let us wrap up, because there are other use cases available, exciting use cases. We need to work through that also. 70-30 rule. 70% of the data for the 7,000 records I can pass for training. 3,000 record I can pass it for testing. When I can, this 75-25, there is no big difference. You can do either one. Then in the sessions, people used to ask, 69 and 31. Why to go for that? These are the global convention. That is also permitted. That is not a big issue. So these two rules, when we can use, when the data is larger in amount, rows are larger, I'm having 10,000 record, then I can choose that. Then 80-20 rule. 80-20 rule, when we can use, is lesser number of records, like 1,000 record, then I need to go for 80-20. If my records are 500, then I supposed to go for 90-10. This is the proportion depending upon the availability of the number of rows. We can pick this train test split model. Then data modeling. When you are ready with the cleaning the data, you need to build the model. That model is based on statistical probability linear algebra. Not only model, the pre-processing also the same. Then coding, you can choose either Python, SAS, R, Julia, Java, any of the suitable language. Even MATLAB, you can do machine learning. So you can do this kind of languages. Widely popular is Python because ready-made availability of the code. Even though we don't know how that model is working, it is possible to build the model. That is the advantage of Python. Model validation. Anytime, if we go for hardware also, software also, testing is mandatory. Even if you want to purchase a mixie, we need to look at whether it is functioning or not. The testing is required. So that is called validation. Finally, we have built the model. Every model will have different matrices. We need to look at the matrices. Whether it gives better accuracy or not, we need to understand. If it is giving better accuracy suitable for our decision making, we are lucky. If not, we need to go for model tuning. That is another sub area. Then revalidation. This is the totality of data model building stages. With that, thank you all for giving me an opportunity. You can proceed with the subsequent session. Thank you all.
Thank you, madam, for the wonderful session.